اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على آل إبراهيم
Yeah, last time when we spoke about the, we were talking about bid'ah actually, last time, and then there was something that we didn't finish, or there was something that I didn't mention at the end, that what some people say about imitating the kafirs. Imitating the kafirs to be haram. That whatever the kafirs do, that we should oppose them, do something different. If the wear watch in the left, it has to be in the right, or if they shave in a way, you have to shave different way. We know that this all comes with the normally those who write about bid'ah, like Al-Bad, like Albani and before him Shatiti or Shatibi or Ibn Taymiyyah, they will always put like chapter about how to contradict the kafirs. To contradict the kafirs, to be an obligation to contradict the kafirs. Contradicting the kafirs, there is nothing in religion that says that we have to contradict the kafirs. Now, if it's in a religion, contradicting the kafirs, meaning not praying their prayer, not worshipping their idols, that is definitely an obligation. Not to pray the prayer of the kafirs, not to worship what the kafirs worship. This is definitely an obligation. All the religion is about this. But to contradict the kafirs just like this, anything that the kafir does, you do the opposite. It has no basis in the Quran or Sunnah. Now, the major hadith that those who say this use is the hadith that the hadith of Ibn Umar, that وَمَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Whoever imitates a group of people, he is one of them. Imitating the group of people will not make them work, make you one of them. Now, if you imitate the Jewish as religion, the Jewish people as religion, you pray their prayer, then you are one of them, you are Jewish. If you imitate the Christian, you are one of them. But if you imitate the British, they have a kind like the way of custom, then you will not become British. If you imitate the Arab, you are not going to become Arab. You imitate the Arab in there, you wear their clothes, or if you imitate the black people, you are not going to become black. If you imitate the white people, you are not going to become white. The hadith that says, وَمَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. This hadith is narrated by Muhammad ibn Abd al-Rahman ibn Thabit ibn Thawban, who is not really strong in hadith. And the hadith starts like this. بُعِثْتُ بِالسَّيْفِ بَيْنَ يَدَيِ السَّاعَةِ. I have been sent with the sword between the hands of the hour. وَجِعِلَ رِزْقِي تَحْتَ ظِلِّ رُمْحِي. And my provision is made under the shadow of my spear. وَجُعِلَتِ الذِّلَّةُ وَالصَّغَارُ وَجُعِلَ الذِّلَّةُ وَالصَّغَارُ عَلَى مَنْ خَالَفَ أَمْرِي. The humiliation is made upon those who opposes my orders. وَمَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Whoever imitate people will be one of them. Now, it's not possible not to imitate people. The kafirs do eat. You can't stop eating. The kafirs do sleep. You can't stop sleeping. And the Prophet, where he say, don't imitate Khaliful Yahud or Khaliful Majus. He never say Khaliful Majus and then he stops, because it will be very difficult. If the Khaliful Majus mean, even if you tell me, okay, eating and drinking, the Prophet used to eat, he used to drink, he was to sleep. If you take this, which is not really something that an argument, but okay, he never, the Prophet never used a car, aeroplane, fork, spoon. All these were discovered first by the kafirs. So we are not supposed to follow them and take them or use them. That's wrong. Don't we know for sure that we shouldn't imitate the kafir by worshipping what they worship, the worshipping by praying their prayer to their idols. This is for definitely. This is the whole Sharia speaks about this. This is the Islam. This is the core of Islam, that you don't worship. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ. That you don't worship what the kafirs worship, the way they worship. But where's the Prophet said خَالِفُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ? He said خَالِفُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اعْفُ عَنِ اللِّحَى وَحُفُ الشَّوَارِبِ. Don't imitate the kafir, leave the beard and cut the mustache. خَالِفُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ paint your beard. Dye your beard, so make it change the color when it's white. But to say open, just like this open statement, Khaliful Mushrikeen, he never said it, and it's not possible that he will say it. It will be like this. Our religion will be based on this, that we will have to worship Allah by doing a survey and looking at the kafirs, what are they doing, and then do the opposite. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, if the Prophet said Khaliful Mushrikeen, our religion will be this. This means we will have to look at the kafirs, what they are doing. It will be part of our religion to look at them, what they are doing, and then do the opposite. If that happens, it's not possible, because these kafirs are not one tribe, not one religion, not one group. There are so many groups of kafirs. Tribes and groups are thousands. Not thousands, hundreds of thousands. One group will leave the beard and cut the mustache. One will cut the mustache and leave the beard. One will leave the beard and the mustache. One will cut the mustache and the beard. So any thing that you are going to do, you will find the kafir is doing it. And then you will not know what to do. So the Prophet will not say this. It's not possible that the Prophet will say this statement. These books that are based on looking at the kafir, what they are doing, and then do the opposite, these books are invalid. Because these people have looked at the kafirs that they live with, and then from there they decided these kafirs are doing this, we have to do the opposite. We live with the kafir who do something different, so we will have to say the opposite what they are saying. And this is not religion. The religion is what Allah has said, what the Prophet has said. This is just because something that I didn't mention last time when we were talking about the bid'ah. But today, actually, the lesson was about the mafhum. Yes.
Sheikh, you say in from the hadith which he says, "Woman
tashabbaha biqawmin
fahum
da'if." It's not da'if according to everybody, because the man that Ibn Thabit Ibn Thawban is considered to be weak by many, is considered to be thiqa by many. And when there is a man like this, you have to make a decision to this. It's not possible that he is thiqa and he is not. That he is trustworthy but he is not. So he is either trustworthy or not.
The thing is, the hadith al-da'if, if we cancel all the hadith al-da'if.
Sorry?
How if we cancel all the hadith da'if?
Yes.
Like most of the hadiths will just cancel.
Yes.
Will be cancelled from the Prophet. But we have to ننسبها إلى رسول.
No.
We have to.
You are saying if we cancel all the hadith da'if, then the hadith that are left are very little. Very few hadith. The very few hadith, yeah, it's fine. The Prophet said, I have been given the eloquency of speech. You see, the very few hadith that you're mentioning, the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim, and the hadith Sahih that are in the six books, are more than enough. Because the Prophet used to have been given the eloquency of his speech. He said, "Utitu jawami' al-kalim." You see, this is the special thing about Quran and Sunnah, that one ayah will cover many aspects in life. This is what the Prophet specially, not the other prophets, only our Prophet was given this eloquency of speech. You see, when he says كل مسكر خمر وكل خمر حرام. Every intoxication is خمر and every خمر is حرام. This is eloquency of speech. That means whatever is discovered after he was asked a question about specific drink, but he gave this general answer, which under this answer now, anything that is discovered now, which is opium or heroin or hashish or anything, or glue that if you smell it will make you intoxicated, all these things are haram by the statement of the Prophet. This is one hadith. And this all the Prophet, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. If someone comes to you and say, I am going to take poison, you read this ayah to him. If someone is going to do wudu when he is sick and the water may harm him, you will tell him this ayah, don't kill yourself in Allah. If someone tells you that I am going to take poison, tell him this ayah. If someone tells you that I am going to smoke cigarette, you tell him this ayah. You understand? One ayah, you can use it in many places.
I think as you said, this hadith, some take it as sahih.
Yes, some people have to take it some sahih, and it's not possible that they are right and they are wrong. And some people have to do a decision about this. And when you look at this man is really not known. And this man has other hadith that even those who consider him to be fiqah don't accept all his hadith. And it's not possible that someone will be trustworthy, not trustworthy. So they have to make up their mind.
The thing is, ظاهري.
Yeah.
They take the hadith from its actual meaning.
From?
Actual meaning. Like
apparent meaning.
Apparent meaning. So there is اختلاف. You know, you say, وَمَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمِ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ.
Yeah.
You went in another thing, don't copy the Jews as the hadith. This is like taking it to the more for the extent,
I have not added anything. I mentioned the hadith. I said the hadith is da'if. It's not possible that the Prophet will have said it. And then I mentioned other hadith. Hadith that's narrated by Bukhari.
Yeah.
Where the Prophet said, don't imitate the Jews. But he didn't stop there. He did, don't imitate the Jews. Keep the beard and cut the mustache. He said it. And another hadith, he said, don't imitate the mushrikeen, dye your beard. So I stopped there. I didn't add to it.
So you say we should only differ from the kafirs in what the Prophet ﷺ specified.
Specified.
If he didn't specify it,
no, then you don't have to differ from the kafir. Of course.
This hadith, فَمَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. This hadith, some ulama took it as, you know, isban, you say izar, but some ulama took it as the trousers. Because it's the first people who did the taking down the trousers under the ankle.
Yeah.
They were gay people.
The قوم لوط.
They wanted to show that they are kind of they are gay.
Yeah, we don't take religion from stories. This is a story. It has no basis.
But this is.
It has no basis. This story, it has no basis. The Prophet didn't say it.
It's not Qamlut, it's in this time.
No. Even there are people, the people that you are talking to, you might misunderstood them, but there is a story that says that the people of Lut used to put their trousers below the ankle, that the Qawm of Lut, they used to whistle, that the Qawm Lut used to clap their hands, they used to understand, and then they say this is haram. While the Prophet didn't say that Qawm Lut have done this, what we know that Qawm Lut did used to get married as well. If they didn't marry women, they won't have children. They won't be a tribe. They used to eat. That's why they were alive. They used to drink. That's why they were living. So you can't say, okay, because they were doing this, we are not going to do it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran what they were doing, the thing that they were doing that we shouldn't do, and he called it fahisha. And Allah, in Allah la ya'muru bil fahisha, Allah doesn't order people to do fahisha. So that is haram to do. And any other thing that you were doing, they were doing business, they were working, they were, you understand, they were sleeping. So you can't just say everything that they used to do is haram. Haram and halal is Allah who will say what is haram and what is halal. Okay, jazakallah khair. Now we go back to the mafhum. The mafhum is the mafhum now. The mafhum is a chapter where meaning the understanding. The mafhum means the understanding. The mafhum can be the fiqh. Understanding meaning. Mafhum is the opposite of mantuq. Mantuq is what has been said. The mafhum, what you can understand from what has been said, even though it has not been said. The word mafhum means understanding, the understood. What is this understood? It's something that is not mentioned in the hadith or in the ayah, but you will understand it from the hadith. Now, those who have studied fiqh will know that Abu Huraira, for example, used to say that if someone wakes up in Ramadan on state of janaba, his fasting is invalid. There was different opinion about this at the beginning. Now this opinion doesn't exist. But there was this opinion before. Al-Fadl ibn Abbas, Abu Huraira used to say, if someone wakes up in Ramadan after Fajr and he is in state of janaba, his fasting is invalid for that day. He said that you have to take shower before Fajr.
Who says that?
Abu Huraira. Abu Huraira and Al-Fadl ibn Abbas. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in Quran, when he mentioned the fasting, he say, أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةِ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ إِلَى نِسَائِكُمْ. The night of fasting, it is lawful to you having a relation with your wives. Until he say, وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. And then it's halal to have relation with your wives and eat and drink until the white thread is clear from the black one, which means until Fajr starts. Now, if you can have relation until Fajr starts, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says afterwards, and then continue your fasting to the night, meaning, if you can have the relation until the last second, and then you have to continue your fasting, that means the ghusl will be later, after the... It's not mentioned, but we understand it. So this is what they call the mafhum, something that you understand from, but it's not mentioned, but you understand it. I give you another example. Another example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, وَالْوَالِدَاتُ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ. The mothers breastfeed their children 2 full years, that is 24 months. Yes? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying in the Quran, وَحَمْلُهُ وَفِصَالُهُ 30 شَهْرًا. His carrying, it means the woman will be pregnant with the baby, he's carrying in her womb. He's carrying and he's suckling 30 months. 30 months, 30 shahra.
But if you count, it's 30.
No, no. Just read I'm reading. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in Quran, 30. Now, if you take 30 from 24 from 30?
6.
That's mean that a boy can live after 6 months. If a woman gives birth to a baby at 6 months, that's mean he can live and have. So this is the minimum a woman can give. If a woman is married and after 6 months, a woman has been married for 6 months and gave birth, We can't say, oh, you have committed something before marriage, because actually 6 months, how did you bring this boy? Because Allah said that his carrying and his upbringing until he finished the suckling is 30 months. Take the two years of the suckling, it stays 6 months. So this is, it's not mentioned here, but this is what we under, how we understand it. Uthman ibn Affan was given a woman, was brought, a woman was brought to Uthman ibn Affan, who was married and after 6 months was given birth. So they accused her of committing adultery before marriage. And then Ali ibn Abi Talib was there and he used this ayah to explain that it is possible. And now it is possible, they know now from the scientific uses, when they take the opinions, I read this in the newspapers, when they take the opinion of this doctors, scientists, before they decide which limit they can terminate the life of someone, like for abortion, they say that it's 6 months that people will live, the babies will live after 6 months. They will come to life and live, can live for a period, or most of the time they will not live.
There's some cases before 6 months as well, Sheikh.
4 months.
Live after the birth.
No, inside.
No, inside they are alive. We know of that. Mm. We are talking about after birth.
When they come out, yeah, as well,
come and have. I don't know about that, but what
they
I have
use,
read...
They use the machine to keep them alive.
Yeah, that's... they can make you use the machine to make a doll move and be alive.
That is... Huh? Still alive until now.
Yes.
3 years
ago. Yeah. Khair, inshallah. Anyway, this is the understanding. I'll give you another example. Many examples will explain more. Now, there is different opinion between the Shafi'is and the majority, whether reading Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim at the beginning of the prayer, loudly or not. The Shafi'is say, when you start the prayer, when you say Allahu Akbar, and then you start reading, you say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. The others say no. You don't say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you start straight away, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you say it silently. And they use different hadith. I will give you one hadith that says, now, the majority agree that Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim must be read. It's only the different opinions whether it has to be read loudly or slowly. Quietly. Yeah. Now, Abu Huraira asked the Prophet, he said, when you start the prayer, between your takbir and your starting of the reading, what do you say? The Prophet said, I say, Subhanaka Allahumma ba'id bayni wa bayna khatayaya kama ba'adta bayna al-mashriq wal-maghrib. Allahumma naqqini min khatayaya kama yunqa thawb al-abyadu min al-danas. Allahumma asilni min khatayaya bil ma'i wa thalji wal barad. He never said, I say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. From this hadith I understand that the Prophet used to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim loudly. Because if he, Abu Hurairah is asking him, what do you say between your reading, your recitation, and between takbir and recitation? What do you say? And he told him, he say this. But he never said, I say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. That's because Abu Hurairah used to hear Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. That's why he didn't say it. It's not in the hadith doesn't mention it, but we understand it. So this is the understanding, the mafhum. The mafhum here is fiqh, understanding, how someone can understand hadith. This is differently acceptable by everybody. But there is one understanding that we don't accept here. The Ahnaf don't accept it, the Zahiris don't accept it. It's called the understanding of the khitab, dalil al-khitab. The mafhum mukhalafa, the understanding of the opposite. Waikum salam wa barakatuh. The understanding of the opposite. If the Prophet says something, gives a rule, for something, the things that he have not mentioned, it has to be to take the opposite rule. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَالْخَيْلَ وَالْبِغَالَ وَالْحَمِيرَ لِتَرْكَبُوهَا وَزِينَ, the horses, the mules, the donkeys, so you ride them and its beauty. He never mentioned eating. So the eating must be opposite. So you shouldn't eat. This mafhum here, this is what we call the opposite of qiyas. Qiyas is called by some people, some kind of qiyas is called mafhum al-muwafaqa, the understanding of the
situation.
No, not muwafaqa, is agreement. It agrees. Huh? The understanding here agree with the mantuq, the one that, the thing that has been said, and the thing that you have to you understand are similar. وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍ, don't tell them off. Meaning, don't beat them. This is the qiyas. So the مفهوم موافقة. If he says don't beat them, he meant don't. If he says don't say off, he meant don't beat them as well. This is qiyas. Yeah, it will be مفهوم المخالفة. If he say don't say off, we stop there. And we do the opposite. Anything else, it's halal. Now you tell me, okay, so you have to take one of these. No, you don't have to take one of these. Actually, the Ahnaf take qiyas, but they don't take mafhum mukhalafa. Ahnaf, all the Ahnaf don't take mafhum mukhalafa. The zahir is don't take qiyas and don't take mafhum mukhalafa. They say, when Allah mentioned, when Allah say, والخيل والبغال والحمير لتركبوها, the horses and the mules and the donkeys, so you ride them and its beauty, you say this is what we understand from here. We don't understand anything else. Eating, we will have to find it out. We will have to look at it. We will have to go to a statement. We will have to go to Quran and look to find out if it's halal or haram. So if we go to Quran and Sunnah, we will find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا, He created for you whatever on the land. Eat, كُلُوا مِمَّا فِي الْأَرْضِ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا, eat from what is on the land, halal. So the horses will be included. And the mules, and the donkeys, except that the donkeys, when we go to the Sunnah, the Prophet said, has forbidden the eating of the donkeys, and he said it's ritz. Ritz, that means impure, khabith, not clean. So it's haram. So we don't take it neither from qiyas, neither from the understanding of the opposite, which is the opposite of qiyas. We don't understand anything, we don't use qiyas, and we don't use the opposite. I'll give you more examples. Because mafhum mukhalafa as well is divided into like categories, like the mafhum mukhalafa of the numbers, of the ghaya, what we call it ghaya, and the shart. I will try to translate every one of these words. The ghaya is the place where you go. If you are going to place the goal, you are going to a place you call, this is ghaya.
Destination.
Okay. This means target or destination or whatever. Now I give you this example. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ مِن بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَنْ زَوْجٍ غَيْرَهُ, if he divorces her, then she is haram for him until she marries another man. Now when a man divorces a wife, his wife, for the third time, she is forbidden for him until she marries someone else. They say, when she marries, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said until she marries another, until she, the mafhum of
فلا تحل له حتى تنكح زوج غيره. Then she is forbidden for him until she marries another man. She says when she marries another man, meaning she is halal for him. Yeah? So that is not true. It's after she divorced or he dies or something. Yeah. So this is ayah. It's not. It's wrong to say this mafhum al-ghaya. What you call mafhum al-ghaya of destination, that you can use it until she marries another man. Okay, when she marries another man, can she marry her husband again? No, she can't. Either until he divorces her, or he dies, or her marriage got annullified for some reasons, then she can marry him. So this is batil. Some people try to say that لا إله إلا الله is مفهوم مخالفة. لا إله إلا الله. Actually, many people say this, but those who know Arabic, those people like Khalil al-Khalil, like Ibn Malik, like even Shanqiti, those people who speak Arabic properly, they say there is no mafhum mukhalafa here. Mukhalafa, mafhum mukhalafa is something you understand but it's not mentioned. And you, the understanding of the opposite. They say La ilaha illallah, meaning we understand it's the opposite. From this statement, we understand that Allah is the ma'bud, the true ma'bud. That's not true. La ilaha is mantuq. Is this said? La ilaha, there is no God. Illallah, it is said. So you don't understand it. It's not mentioned, but you understand it. No, it is said. And this is actually the people of Arabic language, the people of the Arabs don't say this. It's the Usuliyin who say it. And Arabic, you take it from the Arabs.
Sure. Would this be the negation and affirmation? The negation and affirmation for...
No, it's not. Here, La ilaha illallah and Muhammadur Rasulullah, La ilaha illallah is a negation, negating and affirming. Yeah, but it has nothing to do with mafhum al-mukhalaf. There is another thing here, mafhum al-mukhalafa. The way they divide it, they say the mafhum of ghaya, destination, and then the other one is a shart, the mafhum of shart, the condition. وَإِن كُنَّ أُولَاتِ حَمْلٍ فَأَنْفِقُوا عَلَيْهِنَّ حَتَّى يَضَعْنَ حَمْلَهُنَّ. When someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Talaq, if you divorce them, when you divorce women, if they are carrying something, I mean they are pregnant, then spend on them until they deliver their load. It means until they deliver the baby. You have to spend on them. They say the opposite, the understanding of opposite, if they are not carrying anything, then you don't have to spend on them. You understand? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if they are carrying, if they are pregnant, this woman, you have to spend on them. The opposite is, if they are not carrying anything, if they are not pregnant, you don't have to spend on them. So they take it from mafhum al-mukhalafa. We don't take it from mafhum al-mukhalafa, we agree with this, but every Muslim's property is sacred. It's haram, forbidden for anybody. Nobody has to spend money on anybody else, except by the order of Allah. So this man has not been ordered anywhere. We look in the Quran and Sunnah, we didn't find that Allah has ordered him to spend on the woman that he has divorced. He is ordered to spend on his wife. Now he divorced her. She is not his wife anymore. We can't tell him go and spend on other woman. And this is another woman now. She is not his wife anymore. Allah ordered him to spend on her as long as she is his wife. When she is not his wife, he doesn't have to spend on her. So even if there was no this ayah that says that if they are carrying pregnant from you, you have to spend on them, if without this ayah, we will tell him, no, your relation to this woman is finished, you don't have to spend on her. So we didn't take it from this specific ayah, we took it from the hadith that says that every Muslim property is sacred, is haram for others, except with his willing. You understand?
The other one is the mafhum al-adad, the understanding of the numbers. For example, when the Prophet says, whatever Muslim dies, and 40 people pray janaza on him, all of them asking Allah to forgive him or to the intermediate intercede for him, Allah will accept their intercession. Doesn't mean if someone dies and less than 40 people intercede that Allah will not accept their intercession. All of these, for the people who accept mafhum al-mukhalafa, they have different opinions. For example, the majority don't accept mafhum al-adad. This about the numbers, they don't accept. The majority don't accept it. The majority say, yeah, doesn't. If he say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say 40, less than 40 doesn't mean that it's the opposite. It's possible that less than 40, Allah still accept their intercession. So they don't accept that about the numbers. There is another mafhum al-mukhalafa, which has which nobody takes. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say Muhammadur Rasulullah, does it mean Isa is not Rasulullah? Because Muhammadur Rasulullah, does it mean anybody else is not Rasulullah? Musa and Isa, and this one nobody accepted, this kind of mafhum mukhalafa. The truth is, all mafhum mukhalafa, all the understanding of the opposite are not acceptable. Some people say, okay, if these words are mentioned, like Shafi'i, for example, say that the animals, the sheep that are being fed, you see, some people have sheep, they just let them go to the field, graze. Some people, they have the sheep, they put them in place and they buy food for them. We call this sa'ima. The one that goes to the field is called sa'ima, the grazing ones. Now the Prophet said in many statements that sheep, there is zakat in sheep. Like in every 40 sheep, there is one sheep you have to give. Many hadith, general, that for every 40 you have to give one. General, doesn't say the one who grazes or the one that don't graze. But there is one hadith that says, "Fi sa'imatil ghanam zakat," that the grazing sheep, there is zakat in them. Now what do you say? Shafi'i say, if they are not grazing, if you feed them, if you buy food for them, you don't pay zakat. The opposite. The opposite. If the Prophet say, the grazing one, there is zakat in them, meaning the ones that don't graze, the one that you buy food for, you don't have to pay zakat for them. This is the understanding of the opposite. When you don't agree, they will say, why the Prophet will mention this word if it has no benefit? Well, the Prophet will say that the grazing one, if he want to say everything. The Prophet will say that maybe for many reasons. One reason is that someone will come to the Prophet and say, is there zakat? Is there any zakat in the sheep that are grazing? And he will answer it. He will answer that specific question. Now when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ, don't kill your children out of fear of poverty. The understanding of the opposite will say that kill them for other reasons. This is the understanding of the opposite. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَلَا تُكْرِهُ فَتَيَاتِكُمْ عَلَى الْبِغَاءِ إِنْ أَرَدْنَا تَحَصُّنَا. Don't force your slave girls
into committing adultery if they want to be chaste. So if they don't want to be chaste, do we force them to be to commit adultery? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِهِمْ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لَخَبِيرٍ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ بِهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لَخَبِيرٍ صورة العاديات. Help me. Yeah. إِنَّ رَبَّهُمْ بِهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لَخَبِيرٍ. Your their Lord will know them that day. Will be informed by them that day, the day of judgment. What about before that day? This is from مخالفة. This is what is the opposite of قياس.
Sure.
Now, yeah.
What school of thought will accept this, though, Sheikh?
مفهوم مخالفة.
No, I know what you're saying.
The مفهوم مخالفة is accepted by the Malikis, the Hanbalis, and the Shafi'is, but, you know, but the example, not the Hanafis.
But the examples you're giving.
Yeah. No, but they don't say it.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Okay. No, nobody will say this.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying here. What I'm saying is,
if you do,
when you have how it works, مفهوم مخالفة and the قياس are two the opposite things. That. There is no rules. You can pick and choose. Here I do qiyas, here I do مفهوم مخالفة. What you do here is, this is wrong and this is wrong. You have to go back to the dalil. You have to go back to the proof. Always, everything, you go back to the dalil and look for it in Quran. Of course, you may see that you are, everybody agrees about what they say. This ayah here, we come to the same
conclusion.
But the way the route you have taken. Because if you take a route, you have to take it all the time. Mm-hmm. If this is a rule that you use in religion, you have to use it all the time. This is a word that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran, those who say, okay, if this word doesn't mean this, okay, what does it mean? Why Allah will say it? Many of these people will come to a word that Allah has said where you should take it, and then they don't take it. See, Ibn Abbas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in Quran, يستفتونك قل الله يفتيكم في الكلالة. They ask you for fatwa. Say that Allah will give you fatwa regarding kalala. Kalala is someone who dies and has no
heritage.
No ascendance or descendants.
Okay.
No father, no grandfather, and no children. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say inimru'un, and then he explains more. Inimru'un halaka laysa lahu walad, if a man dies and has no children. إِنْ إِمْرُؤٌ هَلَكَ لَيْسَ لَهُ وَلَدٌ وَلَهُ أُخْتٌ فَلَهَا نِصْفُ مَا تَرَكَ. And he has a sister, she will have half of the inheritance. And he mentioned about the brothers and the sister, what they will take. So it is a condition that the sister and the brothers, or the sisters or the brothers and sisters, will take only when there is no children. إِنْ إِمْرُؤٌ هَلَكَ لَيْسَ لَهُ وَلَدٌ. If a man dies and has no children, then the sisters and the brothers can take inheritance. Some people used to say that if someone dies and he has a daughter, she will take half. And if he has a sister, in this case the sister will take half. But in this case here, he has a daughter, so he has children. And Ibn Abbas used to say, أَأَنْتُمْ أَعْلَمُ أَمِ اللَّهِ. You know better or Allah? Allah say, if someone dies and he has no children, you say, even if he has children. This is a word that you have to take, because there is nowhere, you can't find hadith sahih, even though there is hadith which is in Bukhari, from Ibn Mas'ud, that says, but it's not really clear that the Prophet said it, and it's the narration of Abdurrahman bin Tharwan. Abdul Rahman bin Tharwan narrated hadith about the Prophet wiping on his socks, and everybody say it's da'if. So if he is da'if here, it's da'if here as well. There is hadith that where he says that the girls will take inheritance with the sisters will take with the daughters. Ibn Abbas doesn't agree with this because there is no hadith sahih from the Prophet, and the ayah says that when someone dies and has no children, then the sister will have half. If he has sisters and brothers, they will be partners in the inheritance. So this is a word that you have to take. There is another place, another example here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ. We go back to that example. فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ مِنْ بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ. If he divorces her, then she is not lawful to him until she marries, look, حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ. Now we spoke before about the word in Arabic, any word that has two meanings, but we have to take the all meanings except with proof. حتى تنكح زوجا.
Suggest the marriage and have relation.
No. Until تنكح زوجا غيره. Yes. To marry. And now if we say, according to the majority who say the word نكح means زواج rather than relation, meaning marriage rather than relation, having relation, sexual relation, then it will have no meaning. In Arabic, when you say she marries a husband, of course she marries a husband. So the Arabs will consider this talk not to be fluent talking. Huh? When you say a woman married a man, of course she is not going to marry a dog. So she married, you can say she married Muhammad, she married Saeed. Huh? This is more information. They will know who she married. But to say a woman married a man, it has no benefit. A fluent person like the Prophet will not say this. Quran will not say she married a husband. Of course, when she marries someone, she is here. حتى تنكح زوجا غيره. And then here, what is the benefit of this word if you don't use it? This word is beneficial here. حتى تنكح زوجا غيره, meaning if this woman, if she, the man divorces a woman and she commits adultery, if you tell me what's the meaning تنكح زوجا, and he didn't say تنكح only, because if she commits adultery, then it's not enough. If she is a slave and she goes back to her owner and she has a relation with him, it's not enough. She must marry someone and have relation with him.
Really?
Yes.
That's what it's saying, isn't it? Having relation with your husband. It doesn't say just have relation.
Yeah, have so relation with a husband. And this is actually what the Prophet has said. When a woman, there is hadith in Bukhari, a woman was married to someone called Rifa'a, and then he divorced her three times. Then she went and married someone called Abdul Rahman bin Zabir. And then she didn't like to stay with him. She went to the Prophet and she wanted to get back to the first one. The Prophet said, do you want to go back to Rifa'a? No. Until you test his honey and he tests yours, meaning having a relation, sexual relation. This is what the Prophet told this woman. So he explained this ayah. We have spoken before about the words in Quran, meaning that where you have to take the meaning of the word, all the meanings, and here the Prophet explained that this word here means you have to take both the meanings, not one. Of course, if we say we shouldn't take the meaning of marriage, that's because it will be in the Arabic language, it will not be fluent. And it is there, you don't need it, because when he says husband, meaning marriage. Yes.
You said take all the meaning.
Well, this is what everybody should say, because if a word has two meanings, if a word has two meanings, how do you know which one you are going to take?
It's
Well, you have to do ijtihad. A word has two words, and this is Arabic language. Why? What kind of ijtihad? What ijtihad? Ijtihad is this, to take to the two words.
The example you said, حتى.
Yeah.
Yeah. There is in another hadith, يتزوجها أو ينكحها.
Yeah.
إنما الأعمال بالنيات.
Yeah.
This hadith.
Yeah.
Some of them they took يتزوجها.
Yeah. Then, what has this hadith to do with this? The Prophet said, فمن the Prophet said, فمن كانت هجرته إلى دنيا يصيبها أو امرأة يتزوجها. He definitely he has said either he said يتزوجها or he said ينكحها. Huh? And then one of the narrators narrated it by the meaning, but here whoever if the Prophet said يتزوجها, the Prophet said يتزوجها or ينكحها. Huh? It's not possible that he said both of them. You understand? So if he said يتزوجها, then زواج mean only marriage. If he said ينكحها, then yes, some people may do hijrah to go and get married. Some people do hijrah to get to do zina, to do adultery. In all cases, it's haram to do hijrah for this. If you do hijrah to get married, you will get no reward for that. If you go do hijrah to get to for zina, you will get the ithm. Of course, if the word was it ينكحها, all this hadith is it won't make big difference if you take this meaning or this. All we know from this hadith that is your deeds are according to their intention. So if you do if you do your hijrah for to marry a woman, or you do hijrah to get some money, or that's what you will get. You will get nothing else. It's this hadith is really not something that we can take. I can give you my better example here. You see, when Allah Subhanahu wa Taala said, "ولا تنكحوا ما نكحوا أباؤكم من النساء," same word, don't do nikah with the woman that your parents or have done nikah with. Parents mean fathers, your fathers. That's mean your father, your grandfather, your great grandfather. Now, will you say that don't get married to the woman that your parents are married to? Or will you say that you don't have relation as well with the people, with the woman that your parents have relation with? What do you say about this? Do you take the two meanings or only one?
Only one.
Only one. That don't get married to the...
I had this, some alim, I don't know what's his name.
Okay.
He took one meaning.
Okay. Let me talk about your alim then. If someone has a slave, and he had a relation with her, and then he died, and his son inherited his slave, do you say that he will have relation with the slave, or it's haram? Someone had relation, is not married to a woman, had a relation with his slave, which is halal in Sharia, and then he dies. This woman that he has relation with is a slave, is money, property. So his son will inherit her. She becomes his property. Will you say that she is halal for the son after the father had relation with her? Huh? What's the answer?
We take the ayah.
The ayah that says, meaning don't have a relation with the woman that your parents. So you are taking the two meanings. So you're contradicting your alim here. Actually, the majority here, not the majority, it's considered to be ijma', I think. Nobody has said that someone can have relation with from this ayah. They say we take it from ijma'. Well, this ijma' is based on the ayah. The ijma', people will not ijma' from their head. The words in Quran, any word in Quran that has two meanings or more, you have to take all the meanings. Unless you can, here it's not possible. For any reason. When we say, for example,
about the boy, huh? وابتلوا اليتامى حتى إذا بلغوا النكاح. Test the orphans until they reach the age of nikah. Now, you don't say until they reach the age of marriage. There is no specific age for marriage. So until they reach the age where they can have relation, because the boys can't have relation at certain time until they, until they reach the age of puberty. Hmm? That's because it's not possible. That way we don't take the one meaning. Oh, see, this is how. Huh?
No. Okay, you see, when you said about the slave and his son, can he have intercourse?
Yeah.
But how would you know if he had intercourse with his slave?
Well, that's what we have to know. That's what she said. If the father.
What can he do if he inherits the slave?
Yeah. He can ask her. Where there is, accept her only her word, where there is nothing, the woman will say, of course. Umar ibn Khattab, when he was dying, he told his children, this woman is not okay for you. I had relation with her. So this is what normally people will say.
Someone got killed for that, isn't it, Sheikh?
For what?
Somebody was ordered to be killed because
he got married to the wife of his father.
He got married to her.
Yeah. The one that Prophet sent someone to kill him.
Yes.
Yeah. That person has... Well, when someone here, it's clearly that this man has wed a woman. You see, when someone commits zina, he will commit zina. He will hide and do it. Yeah? And not talk about it. And even if he talk about it... But when he... celebrate it and call people, and he's making it halal. He considered it to be halal. And then if you make halal haram, then you are not, someone who makes halal haram is not a Muslim. So he was killed because he was not a Muslim, it's not because he committed zina or something. Committing zina as well for someone who is married will make his blood halal. But in a different, you kill him in a different way, of course. He will be stoned to death. Yes?
No, sorry,
last
question. It's got nothing to do with this.
Yeah.
Khair,
inshallah, it's fine. Because this is, I told you, it's a very small subject, and we have, this is what I want to go and say anyway. We have finished, and the time is Isha.
Are you going to continue your next lesson about Mafhum?
Mukhalafa. No, for Mukhalafa it's very simple. We are going to go through these lessons again, inshallah, from now we are going to, when we finish this summary, we are going to go through the book and take a book with someone saying things. We will read the book and whether we agree with him or whether we disagree with them. Hmm? Of course, you know, usul fiqh, except from the four, the two things that are agreed on is Quran and Sunnah. Every Muslim agree on this, that Quran and Sunnah are the source of the religion. And then Ijma', different opinions about it, then Qiyas, and then like Ijma', Ahmed ibn Hanbal say it's invalid, and then Qiyas, Zahir is Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and then Qiyas, the Zahiris and Ahmed Muhammad say is invalid. And then Mufhum al-Mukhalafa, the Hanafis and the Zahiris say is invalid. And then the Istihsan, the Shafi'is and the Malikis and the Hanbalis and the Zahiris say is invalid. Istihsan is another subject. It's a very simple thing. Is to decide that this is good, this is obligation, this is haram. This is wajib, this is wrong, based on nothing except the aql. You look at something with...
Is it a bit like Sadd
al-Daraya? Yeah, it's maybe, but it's not even based on that. Huh? It's just you look at something, oh, this thing is good. It should be wajib, it should be haram, it should be... And this is what many people do.
And they have a branch in Usul al-Fiqh about this.
The Ahnaf have the qiyah, they do istihsan. Okay. The Shafi'i has a strong statement against it. He wrote about it. He said whoever does istihsan, he has
created new, he has started a new sharia.
Istihsan.
Istihsan.
So do they all differ? Like, for example, you said that qiyas is opposite of mafhum
mukhalaf.
So basically, they choose what they desire. Each madahib.
No, it's not. We don't accuse people of desire.
In a bad way.
Some people, yeah. Some people, it is. This is what they say. When you go to Shawkani, when he says speaks about qiyas, and then when people say the Prophet used to do qiyas. Even though he might agree with them that Prophet has done qiyas, which is not true. The Prophet, وَمَا يَنْتَقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى, he doesn't talk out of his desire. Whatever he says is wahy. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. It is revelation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't do qiyas. The qiyas is done by people who don't know. People don't know the rule, and then they do qiyas. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if someone says Allah has done qiyas, and some people say it out of ignorance, then it's a big statement. Allah does qiyas. When you say that qiyas is for someone who doesn't know the rule, and he is comparing things and to come with the rule, the Prophet is not doing except to transmit the revelation that comes from Allah. So he's not doing qiyas as well.
So what's the strongest dalil for using mafhum mukhalif? What's the dalil that they use?
Mafhum mukhalifa.
Yes.
It's exactly the same thing what you do from qiyas. Is that okay? Exactly. This is what people understand. This is what the majority of people are doing.
Basically.
Of course, different.
And but the Shafi'is, Hanbalis, and Malik has used it. You said
they use it in certain ways. Yeah. Not generally, but they disagree about which kind of mafhum mukhalafa they have to accept.
So they would pick and sometimes choose.
Pick and choose.
Other times.
Yeah.
But like you're saying, if you use it this time,
you've got to use it all
of course,
time.
Yeah. All
the
time, but they have divided the mafhum mukhalafa into, you see, many times when you come, and then people will cases, people will say, okay, is it qiyas here or mafhum mukhalafa? And they debate, and then they agree that it's not clear whether you have to use just based on like opinion. Maybe it's almost, maybe it looks like we have to. It looks like.
So when that time we were talking about the Salah, we said the ayah for intabu aqams or akhwanakum fi din, you were saying it's opposite there. Is that mafhum mukhalafa?
No,
is that something else?
No. The kafirs are not our brothers. Yes? Generally, we know the kafirs are our enemies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لا يتخذوا عدوي وعدوكم أولياء. And then he said, until they do this. So we didn't know, understand that before they do salat and before they do zakat, they are not our brothers. We don't understand it from this ayah. We understand it from the ayah that says, لا تتخذوا عدوي وعدوكم أولياء. Don't take my enemy and your enemy as friends. We don't take it from al-mu'min akhul mu'min, meaning the kafir is not the believer. You understand? We go to another ayah. If we say that it says something similar, it says something similar. If it says something opposite, it's opposite. Yeah. It has to be either similar or opposite.
So the ayah,
but we don't take it from this specific hadith. We have to go to the other hadith and.
But the ayah that says fa'ikhwanakum fi din, that doesn't mean that before they weren't your brothers. Is that what you're saying?
No, this ayah doesn't mean that before they were not your brothers. Not this ayah, don't understand that they were before our brothers or our enemies. So we have to go to Quran, and Quran will say that they were our enemies before. Not this ayah.
So if they don't pray?
Yeah, they were our enemies. But it's not this ayah that told us this.
Okay, I understand it's not the...
Yeah, it's the other Quran, the whole Quran. لا تتخذوا عدوي وعدوكم أولياء. And so
if it was just for this ayah to ensure that they were...
We don't know. We can't know. They were our enemies or our brothers or...
Sheikh. Yes.
Sheikh,
you say some ulama use al-ikhtilaf and majmu'at.
مفهوم المخالف.
You don't have to use it everywhere. You have to use it in some occasions.
Yeah, but why? What are these occasions? How?
How do you define?
Like qiyas, you say there is a different. You have to qiyas. You use it when you don't have the dalil.
No.
When you don't have the thing.
Yeah, that. But I am saying that there is dalil everywhere, for everything.
in some occasions.
No, there isn't. There is no some occasions. Give me an example.
It's not like
that. Okay, you go and think about it, and next time shall I bring an example. Wait, no, about the places where there is no dalil.
When did it get standardized and part of the deen?
Yeah.
When it became like a rule in usul fiqh? Who introduced Shafi. It?
Shafi.
Was it Shafi that introduced it?
The mufhum mukhalafa.
Or were there people before doing it, but they didn't say it?
Mufhum mukhalafa.
Yeah.
Mufhum mukhalafa is not known before at the as word dalil khitab, as a rule.
Yeah.
Like it's not known. It's before Shafi'i.
So who opposed Shafi when he first, you know, for something to come out new, there must have been someone in the beginning who opposed him and said, "This is what you're saying here." Is
well, we don't know who opposed him. Ibn Shafi'i in his books doesn't speak about mufhum mukhalafa the way we understand it. And these things, you know, they evolve, they change from. Who opposed him or who approached him, we don't know these things. We don't know who approached Shafi'i about Qiyas or about Ijma' or about anything.
But not necessarily him, but as it went down the line,
yeah.
Like Dawood al-Zahiri, he didn't take Qiyas.
He doesn't take all of these except Quran and Sunnah.
But Sheikh, surely if Shafi'i brought it out or invented it, that must have
been we don't say he invented it. People used to do it. People do it.
Was it a minority opinion at the time?
We don't say it's a minority opinion. Mufhum mukhalafa, this is what people do. This is what people normally do. It just we say it's in a religion we shouldn't.
For nature, you mean?
Yeah.
Nature.
People, this is what normally people do. Sometimes they understand mufhum mukhalafa, but not where you understand mufhum mukhalafa, I might not understand it. And not religion is not left to us to understand what some people, everybody follow what he thinks and. You understand?
Sure. Some hadiths you take it from Buhari, and some you say, you know, it's daif.
We take hadith.
Some you accept and some no.
No, we don't say some accept and some no. We look at the isnad. Still, we look at the isnad. Allah has protected the religion, and alhamdulillah, Buhari has brought the isnad, and it's still there. So the isnad, the chain of narrators,
yeah.
The man, and so we can look at them and still decide which hadith to be accepted or which not. When we say hadith is da'if or sahih, I don't say, oh, this hadith is da'if because I don't like it. Huh? We say this hadith is da'if because this man, I will mention the name of the man, and we say that some people said he is weak. I will not even bring a hadith and say, oh, this hadith is da'if because there is man that everybody said he is tiqa, but I don't like him. And we say, Ahmed Muhammad said da'if, Ibn Ma'in said da'if, Ibn Madini said da'if. However, then some people may say tiqa. It's not possible that someone is weak and he's strong in the same time. He is either weak or strong. And then it's left for you to look and make a decision, and you say why you say this person is da'if. When I said earlier, I mentioned one hadith and said this man is weak, the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, I said Abdul Rahman ibn Tharwan is weak, I said because this man make mistakes, and I gave an example that this man narrated a hadith that the trustworthy people said narrated this hadith from Mughira ibn Shu'bah, they said the Prophet wiped over his khuf, this man said over his socks, and this is not something acceptable in religion that someone make mistake like this. So this person, we can't trust him. It's not the question that he is bad. Maybe his memory is weak and he make mistakes. So you can't rely on him. Someone like this might bring hadith from Ibn Mas'ud, say the Prophet said it. There is the adhan now. Inshallah, we continue next week. Inshallah.